Good evening, everyone who has joined from India, and good afternoon and good morning to those who have joined from different parts of the world. Thank you for joining us in the webinar. This is in the series of webinar we are doing it from LASIP. In the last webinar, we have covered how project management and Six Sigma related. So you can view the recording of this webinar under LASIP.org webinar section. And today's webinar is on overview of control chart, which has been given by Mr. Radhakrishnan Balagopal, who is a lead consultant with Capgemini. Radha, can you change the slide? Now, before we move on to the webinar presentation, now I will take you through some of the ground rules. The total duration of this webinar will be of 45 minutes, in which presentation duration will be of 30 minutes and question and answer session will be of 15 minutes. You can post your question on the webinar chat box, which is on the right hand side of your screen. The video of this webinar will be available at the links which you can see on the screen. After the webinar is over, links will be mailed to you so that you can hear the recording of that. Presentation is available for only our download for our professional members and corporate members only. In case of any problem, you can contact me. You can see my email ID on your screen, and if you want to call me personally, you can. The number is given is there on your screen. Now, before we move on to the let me introduce to our presenter, Mr. Radhakrishnan Balagopal. Radhakrishnan Balagopal is having 8+ years experience in IT. During his 8+ year experience, he is a project manager managing application development and maintenance project in Java J2E technologies. He is also a process consultant, quality assurance expert, mainly experienced in process definition and implementation in financial sector. And he is also strong in improvement and transformation initiative, data-driven analysis also. Dada, can you move on to this next slide? Just wanted to let you know about what is LASIP. LASIP is into lean. LASIP means Lean and Six Sigma International Board, which is a not-for-profit society in the area of Lean and Six Sigma and business excellence. It was conceptualized in 2009 by two top industry leaders and came into existence in 2010, and it was registered in 2011. Lean and Six Sigma concepts are here to stay, and we are here to spread the awareness of Lean and Six Sigma concept and share learnings for community at large through our best-in-class knowledge base, which you can download. You have to just complete a small registration process, and then you can download all the best-in-class free material from our from LASIP. Radha, can you move on to next slide? Now, LASIP has touched over 10,000 professional lives from 40+ countries in just 1.5 years. Radha, move on to the next slide. Now, without any further ado, I now hand over to Mr. Radha for their presentation. Radha, over to you.
Okay, thank you, Varun. Good evening, everybody, and good afternoon to all my friends who are joining from different parts of the world, as Varun said. So, in this session, I would debriefingly giving you an overview about control charts, and you know, many of you would be using control charts in your day-to-day improvement initiatives. And what we are going to cover during the next 30 minutes is you know, what control charts are, what are the benefits, why are we using them, what types of control charts are there, how are we going to interpret different control charts based on different rules, and what further development has happened in the field of statistical process control, and what role does the control charts play in them. So So that's what we're going to cover in the next 30 minutes. At the end of the session, you can post your questions. Whatever I can answer immediately, I would do that, or else we would get back to you with the appropriate answers and further clarifications. So to start with, you know, what exactly is a control chart? You know, we all have heard about different quality control tools, and you know, the commonly used terminology in quality control tools when we deal with are the 7 quality control tools. So they span from, you know, the cause and effect analysis diagrams, to check styles, to control charts, to run charts, to histogram, Pareto analysis, scatter analysis, and so on. So control chart plays a very important role in statistical process control, especially with respect to controlling and monitoring the process inputs. Now, this was developed by Dr. Walter A. Shewhart, and this was developed way back in 1920s, and then, you know, it further got improved, and you know, it has been extensively used since 1950s. It finds its relevance and usage extensively in the manufacturing and services sectors across the globe. And now it is being used to measure the process stability and the process capabilities as well. Now, in terms of Six Sigma terminologies, this is a tool which is used across the phases. Especially its relevance comes in the control phase to see whether the improvements which have been made are statistically significant. Now, if you briefly talk about what the benefits of control charts are, you know, it helps in monitoring, you know, how a process has performed over a period of time. Now, especially with respect to process performance, there is a specific terminology which is assigned to how a process performs. So that is the capability of a process and the stability of a process. A process has to be both stable as well as capable, and it meets the specifications, and also it helps in reducing the variation. What is the advantage of that? We are able to have more predictable results from the process outputs when we have more predictable inputs from the process. Special causes and common causes of variations are terms which we may all have heard when we talk about statistical process control. Now, when Dr. Shewhart talked about special causes and common causes of variation, there was a very interesting example which he used to explain special and common causes of variation. So I would take up that example here. Now, you all imagine a dartboard which has a bullseye. So a person is shooting to the bullseye from the on the dartboard. Now, as he shoots, you know that even if he is the smartest shooter in the world, he or she is the smartest shooter in the world, he or she may not be able to hit the bullseye on all occasions. So the hits may vary across the dartboard. You know, maybe if he's a very smart shooter, almost 80 to 90% of the hits may hit the bullseye, or some may fall here or there. Now, so there is a small variation in the way, you know, the shooting happens, and the target hits the bullseye. Now, that is inherent variation in the process. So that's a common cause. Whereas if the shooter decides to shoot only on the right hand side of the bullseye, so all the hits would be concentrated on the right side of the dart. So that means he or she is doing it with the purpose. So that's a normal thing which does not happen in a in a normal process of shooting at a dartboard. So there is an intention. So the intention could could be found out by a detailed root cause analysis, but that's a special cost. Another simple example which we are taking is that, you know, if you are commuting to your office, you want to reach your office by 8:30, and you know, with a plus or minus 5 minutes of you know variation in reaching office. So the specifications are you have to be in office by 8:30. That's the time which has been set by the office authorities. Now you might you have collected the data over the past say like 6 months, and you have found that you know on most occasions you are reaching at 8:25 or sometimes at 8:35, or the data lies in between 8:25 and 8:35. Now there might be also few instances where because of roadblocks or maybe because of some special occasions at home, you would have reached office at 9 o'clock or 9:30, or you may have fallen sick. So these are all special causes. So these are all assignable causes which you can assign a cost to. This is not inherently in your day-to-day process of coming to office. So when you measure the output of coming reaching the office at 8:30, you know that these two, three outliers, as we call it, can be assigned to certain instances which has happened. And what further benefits which we get from control charts, it helps in identifying also if the process change has resulted in a process improvement. People go to the extent of saying that control charts are a graphical representation of an hypothesis testing, where we can say whether the improvements which have been made are statistically significant or not. Now, before getting into the types of control charts, I would like to take you through what are the different types of data which we have. We have broadly we classify data as continuous data and attribute data. We also have different types of other classification, say like nominal, ordinal, integral, and ratio data. So here we are primarily talking about continuous data and discrete data. Most of you, we all come across both types of data in our day-to-day life. Continuous data are data like, you know, these are information which can be measured on a continuous scale. So it can have any numeric value. So it can be length, width, you know, volume, speed, temperature, cost, anything which is measurable. So we deal more with continuous data in our work and, you know, also in our day-to-day life. As opposed to, you know, continuous data, when it comes to discrete data or attribute data, this more or less depicts the presence or absence of a particular characteristics. So it's like, is the product or not defective? You know, can I accept this output or can I reject this output? So it's more of a particular absence or presence of a particular characteristics. So it's never a decimal or a fraction. It's more of this will always be a whole number. So that's primarily an attribute data. And based on the data type, the type of control charts also vary. You know, and we would see in the next slide what are the types of control charts and, you know, which control chart has to be selected when and what pitfalls which we may have when we choose a different type of control chart which is not appropriate. Now, broadly, we have classified control charts as based on the attribute data and continuous data. Now, we will start with attribute data. Now, here you see that for attribute data, it follows different types of distribution. So, it could be a Poisson distribution, or it could be a binomial distribution, and we also deal with data based on what that data is representing. For instance, you know, the P type of chart and the NP type of charts are used to plot percentages of defective or proportions of defective. So in a sample size of say 1,000, how many are defective, percentage defect? You may be receiving a lot of forms in your offices, or say, let's take the example of an insurance company. The percentage of forms which the insurance company receives as incomplete. So such types of scenarios, we talk more about, the P and the NP charts. And these charts are generally the distribution of percentage defective would be binomial distribution. Whereas when we are talking about the count of defects, then we are talking about more about C charts and U charts. So there, it's the number of defects is the interest which we are trying to exhibit in a control chart. Now, coming back to examples of C chart, U chart, NP chart, and P chart. Let's take the example of an instance where an insurance company receives incomplete forms. Now, this can also be a case where I have a production process where I'm producing glasses. Now I produce glasses based on the demand of my customer. So mostly I do a just in time manufacturing. I don't my production process is tuned in such a manner that I have a pull production rather than a push production. So what I do is, based on my demand, I vary my production. So that means that on each day, the amount of output which I am producing varies based on the demand. Suppose I am producing glass panes. So and I have any I will have an unequal sample space when I take a sample each hour to see whether the glass has scratches, the glass has puking or any other defects, which is as defined by my specifications. So as and when I have an unequal sample size and I have to measure the percentage or proportion of defectives, I generally use a P chart. Now here, when we talk about sample size, we have to actually bring in an important concept called as rational subgrouping. So what is meant by rational subgrouping? Now I can look at sample size in totality. For instance, we all work in offices, so we know that as we start our day, we generally are more focused. Our productivity is better, but towards end of the day, our productivity is less. Similarly, when we talk about a certain production process which happens in batches, it might be the case that each batch may not produce the same. There would be an inherent variation in the output which is coming out from the batch. So the concept of rational subgrouping is that we actually use a logical way of picking up samples from the population. So for instance, I may on each day at a particular time. So for instance, I am talking about producing glass panes. So every on a particular date, say like today being 27th, I would look at 7 o'clock in the morning, I am picking up 3 or 4 samples from a batch of 1,000 glass panes which I have produced. So now at 8 o'clock, I again pick up another 4 samples from the batch of say 700 which I have produced. So the sample size is kind of varying, but What I am trying to do is I am trying to have take the different sample size and plotting my control chart to see whether there are any inherent variations in the process of producing these glass panes. Now, when we go to NP chart, here we are talking about equal sample size. So I don't do a push or pull production, where I do more of a constant production. My rate of production of like I'm producing bulbs, so I produce 1,000 bulbs every hour, and I want to test. It's a very rigorous sampling and testing process, so I want to test all 1,000 of them. So what I would do is I would take all the 1,000 and test everything, and each day I would continue. So that is picking up 1,000 from each day and plotting a control chart is actually we are using equal sample size with NP chart. When we go, so here in both the cases we want to find out how many items of these bulbs or how many items of these glass planes were defective. So that's why we use the NP chart and the P chart. Whereas when we are more concerned about the defects, then we could use the same examples. But when we are talking more about number of defects, we use a C chart and a U chart. Okay. Now, when it comes to C chart and U chart, again, C chart we will use it when we have an equal sample size. So, like in the case of bulbs, as we took 1,000 bulbs. Similarly, for C chart also, we might use 1,000 bulbs, and we want to find out how many of them, how much is of that is has defects. So, in a distribution which is of Poisson in nature, we use C chart and U chart, and in a distribution which is of binomial in nature, we use an NP chart and a P chart. Now, going to continuous data, we generally do choose the control charts based on the sample size. Now, we can have a sample size where, you know, which is where n equal to 1, where we use an individual or moving range chart. Now, that means when do we use that? We use it when the data is very expensive, or, you know, when the recurrence of that is, it happens only once in a quarter. For instance, in IT field, if we talk about it, we do releases once in quarter. So the data occurrence is very, it's not that common. So, or the rate at which the data is produced is too slow. In such scenarios, if we have to measure, if you have to plot a control chart for continuous data, we generally take each instances of sample size we use and individual or moving range chart. Whereas, as part of rational subgrouping, if our n is greater than 10, we use an X bar S chart. Why an X bar S chart is because S is standard deviation here, is because standard deviation generally is a better measure for spread when we have generally a larger sample size. So, whereas when the sample size is between 1 to 10, we generally use a X bar range chart, which is X bar R chart. Now, in instances where X bar S chart is used and X bar R chart is used, you generally tend to get two graphs, one with an X bar and with an S, and one with an X bar with an R. And we would see the rules of how we would be interpreting these control charts in the subsequent slides. The examples of where we can use X bar chart or X bar S chart or IMR chart are are very much relevant depending on the nature of the process which we are handling as part of our statistical process control. Going to the key terms in a control chart, we explained about rational subgrouping. It's a logical way of sampling data and picking up samples which are relevant, and rather than picking up just random samples, so that we understand our process better, we understand our process performance better. A control chart generally has an upper control limit, lower control limit, and a central line. In a typical 3-sigma chart, we all know that the 99.73% of data falls under the area under the curve. We use a mean plus or minus 3-sigma. Now we also the key terms in a control chart are what are the common causes and special causes, which we spoke about earlier, and we would also understand whether a process is stable or whether a process is unstable, or and whether a process is capable as well. Now, there are different rules which are available, which are generally used for interpreting a control chart. We have heard about multiple rules. Generally, and the most relevant rules which are used are in the industry are Western Electric rules, then Automotive Industry Action Group rules. There are also multiple other rules. There are companies which customize their rules to interpret the control charts as well. So if we go to the Western Electric rules, we find that it comprises of four major checkpoints actually. One is no single data should fall outside the 3-sigma limit. Two of the three consecutive points fall beyond the 2-sigma limit of the central line. Four of the five consecutive points fall beyond the 1-limit. When we eight consecutive points fall on the same side of the central line, when we have such observations while interpreting the control chart, we know that there is something happening in your process. So we would analyze the process further. We know that it's not stable. There is some inherent special cause or assignable cause of variation which we can see. So what we do is we analyze it better. Automotive Industry Action Group actually runs with five rules which are listed below. I've put examples for that which can also be seen in the subsequent slide. This is one process. The first slide, the graph which you see, is a process where the process is pretty much stable, an ideal process. It has only common causes of variation. There are no assignable causes of variation. What you see the data moving across is because of the inherent process variation in the process. Now, if you look at the first case, wherein there are presence of assignable causes, so we see that above the upper control limit, and there are points below the lower control limit as well. So there were certain instances which caused the output to go beyond the control limits of a particular process which is under the monitoring. So what we do in such instances, we actually do a thorough analysis. We might remove these outliers in our further calculations, but that doesn't mean that we don't investigate them. We investigate and understand why these assignable causes came into existence. The next set, you will see that there is a trend, 7 points continuously on one side and 10 points on 10 out of 11 points on one side. Then you know that there is a trend, a pattern which you are seeing in your process. So you need to analyze and find out what's happening on that particular timeline in your process. This is where the rational subgrouping plays a very important role. Maybe there is a small shift which is happening in your process which you want to analyze and find out. Again, another instance of 7 points trending upwards or 7 points trending downwards, you would do further analysis of this. Again, this is another, the fourth instance where, you know, there is a periodicity which is happening at regular intervals. So you know that it's kind of becoming a pattern. Now the last one is also where you see that most of the points are approaching the central line. So that also needs either the data has to be analyzed further to understand why most of the points are approaching towards the central line. Now, one of the challenges, or I wouldn't use the term drawbacks, but I would say kind of limitation of Shewat's control charts were that it was not in a position to identify small process shift. Now, this is beyond the scope of this overview presentation, but generally, you know that there can always be a debate about what is a special cause and what is a common cause of variation. A common cause of variation now can become a special cause as the specifications become tighter, as your process becomes more mature, as your variation in your process reduces. So the limitation of Shewat's chart was that it was able to identify only major process shift, generally in tune of 1.5 sigma. But small process shifts, which are significant in mission critical applications or products, Shewat's chart was not able to give the correct output. So what happened was that it resulted in the development of exponentially weighted moving average chart, cumulative sum control chart, and in real complex business scenarios, we also have real-time contrast charts. So summarizing, control charts are, if used effectively, will give us a very good control and very good overview of how your critical processes are performing and whether they are able to meet the specifications set by the customers, and whether their outputs would be predictable. We can use control charts to monitor our inputs to the processes as well as the output of your critical processes. Thereby, we would be in a position to manage and give more predictable outputs to our customers. That's it from me. We can have our questions.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Radha, for the wonderful and informative presentation today. We will now start the question. First, before we move on to the question answer session, the next, I just wanted to let you know that the next webinar is on Cano analysis, which is given by Mr. Upendra Karthik, who is the CEO of Saudi Harmony. The next webinar will be on the same day, the next Thursday at 7:30 p.m. IST. Now I would like to thank our presenter for the wonderful and informative presentation today. We will now start the question and answer session. Just as a reminder, if you have comments or questions regarding the information shared in the presentation, you can contact Mr. Radhakrishna anytime after this webinar. Now we will wait for the first question. Sir, first question is on your chat box. Radha?
Should I answer or should I?
Yes, yes, you should answer that.
Yeah, okay. When should we change, it's a good question, when should we change the control limits? Now, control limits, you actually change your specification limit. You don't change your control limits. your control limits are derived data, so you don't go and change them. So as and when your process variation reduces, your control limits would keep on reducing, approaching towards the central line. So that's when, you know, actually you find that your process variation has reduced, and it is not only all the data points or most of the data points are not only falling within the control limits but also within the specification limits. That means it's predictable as well as it meets our goal as well. And any chart if you take, whether attribute or control, all these control limits are derived from the data, from the process data which you have, which is the output of your process. So we more derive the control limits. Now when we remove the outliers and we compute again, or if we see a major shift in your process, then also your control limits would change. Now when do we say an improvement has happened? It is when we either see the reduction in the variation of your process. That means more data points come under the area under the curve in a normal normal distribution, or else we assume we see a major significant shift in the process mean. So this is when we see that, you know, a significant improvement has been made. Yeah.
The second question is on to your chat box.
Yeah, it's a very interesting question. How to interpret a control chart containing majority of zero values? No, this is when majority of zero values is you have to know it is important to understand what the zero value is and what you are trying to measure. Now, if it is variance, for instance, I am measuring the variance of, say, like I will take the example of you reaching office and you want to understand how many what was the percentage variance which you had with the expected goal of reaching office at 8:30. Now if you think you are spot on and reaches on most of the occasions at the zero value, then what happens is your process is operating at a very, very optimum level where it is more, attuned towards your average value, and it is more predictable in terms of whether you will reach office at 8:30 tomorrow or not. So, or else there is a major problem with data collection. You should further dig down into data, you should stratify the data, you should segment the data, stratify the data. Maybe you are taking the entire population into consideration, so you can further drill down and look at the in-process performance. So maybe you are tracking f of x, f of larger x, maybe you can start tracking f of x1, x2, x3 so that you kind of get data which is more interpreting towards or converging towards your value.
The third question is on your chat box, Radha.
Yeah, it is individual or moving range chart. So suppose, say, as I said in an example, when we have to do a sampling, or when we have instances where we have to do destructive testing to test a sample to see whether the process is performing, then our sample size n is 1, or your process output is too slow. You do only one release in a year to production, or your process output is too slow or it is too costly, that is when the sample size n is 1, that is when you use your individual moving range or SMR chart.
Thank you, Radha. That's all the question we have for today. And that's all the time we have for today's presentation. Thank you for attending the webinar. I hope that you join our next webinar on Thursday, which is at 7:30 p.m. Indian Standard Time. Thank you, Radha. Thank you all, and thank you. Goodbye for now.
Thank you.